that's only 17% of borrowers with active syndrome.
What's called the berry button, the red button that I hit.
Hey,
everybody, welcome to the first ever Laugh, Lend, and Eat Live on LinkedIn Live. I'm sorry, I'm going to jump on something real quick, Christine. I wish I was Josh Pitt right now. You know how Josh is like, good morning, America!
Yep.
It's time to shred. Can't do that, man. I'm way too calm for this. But anyway, I hope everybody's enjoying the show right now. It's the first live Laugh, Lend, and Eat podcast we're doing. I am joined by an amazing panel. Some people that I've really, really begun to admire. First and foremost, it is my dear friend who's here to hold my hand virtually, the founder of 2020 Vision for Your Success Coaching, Christine Beckwith. Christine, how are you?
Hi, everyone.
Corrina Carter from Virginia Beach, founder of CMS Mortgage Solutions. Corrina, cool.
Hey,
glasses.
Everybody.
And then we got my buddy, Kiran Shah, all the way from Atlanta, Georgia, coming in for First Option. How you doing, Kiran?
Guys.
Is it hot down there still? I just left. So
yes, very much so.
It was like 90 degrees at 9 o'clock at night.
Atlanta.
Like, that's not cool, right?
I'm ready for winter.
Bring it on.
Hey, by the way, in wintertime, what happens in Atlanta? It like goes down to 70?
Yeah, 60.
All right, well, look, let's talk about what we are here for. You guys and Corrina and Kiran and Anna Marie obviously had to cancel at the last second, and so we all wish her well, but Anna Marie included, you three were winners of the past year's Women with Vision Awards. So congratulations.
Thank
That's
you.
A great accomplishment. And I wanted to go with Christine because this is going to be like a new format, hopefully, if we're experimenting with this, so see how it goes, right? For Laugh, Lend, and Eat to make our shows a little quicker. But what I want to ask you, Christine, because this was a question that when we and John were sitting around thinking about this, like, how did Christine come up with this idea to give women this award? Because it is unusual in our industry, by the way, Christine, what you've done, right? So you've kind of said, hey, there's some people in the industry that I want to recognize, namely females, mm-hmm. that are going above and beyond the norm. So walk me through that process.
Yeah, you know, I think when I got into consulting and I looked back over my own career, I can remember exactly where I was when I received my first award and recognition, which was the top 50 women at the time by MPA magazine in 2015. And it was hard to get that top 50 seat. I think, you know, Annie Mac at the time was my employer, and I think 400 and something people nominated me for that award for me to get into that top 50 spot. And it changed my career. And so as I became a consultant and built content and curriculum and a place for people to grow their businesses, I said, you know, we have to have an award. And MBA actually called me. Because they told me that they were retiring their award that I had won three times in my career, and that there would be an opening for a new award to be built. And so I said, oh, I'm so glad you're telling me this. And it gave me the idea that I could kind of take the baton from them and build my own brand, and that there would be a space for it. And I think today there are a lot of awards for women, and I think it's an important part of their resume. I think it's shining a light on, you know, their talents. I like to say, you know, Women with Vision is a business school for business executives and leaders in our space. We have the largest school and contingency of women that are consulting their businesses of the American banking industry, which I'm really proud of. So we have hundreds of women that are here leading, you know, small brokerages all the way up to large executive lending spaces. And the mission is just to better, you know, get better results with their businesses and to make them really strong, competitive business leaders.
That's awesome. So Kiran and Corrina, you guys were both first year recipients, I believe, right? If I'm not mistaken. So if I'm right.
Second year.
Okay, yeah. I was mistaken. First.
Yeah. Kiran's 2 years. She's a 2-timer, I think.
Christine actually remembers all this stuff. That's crazy. Yeah. Of all the winners, that's amazing. So, let me ask you guys something. When you guys are like, I'm sure nobody actually does this, right? Like actually work so hard so that they qualify for an award. Is that a silly way to put the question? What I'm looking for is, like, when you guys are working, you're not thinking about getting awards or nominations for awards, right? I mean, you're just out there doing the best you can, right, Corrina? I mean, is that an accurate way to put it?
Yeah, that's actually very accurate. I mean, no one thinks about, especially in the business and being a woman in our field as far as financial aspects of it, no one really thinks about, hey, I'm doing this because I want to be better than somebody, or I want to be better and want to get this award. It's just a matter of first in, I come in, I'm the first one here, last one to leave, and we just keep grinding, right?
Yeah. And so, I mean, I noticed with your group, you have a lot more younger females part of your makeup. So I'm sure it's not a pressure or anything, but obviously you're now becoming a role model for them, winning this award and kind of being celebrated. I mean, how does that make you feel about that?
Well, I'm really excited about that. And part of that reason is because the way I came into the industry. So I had women leaders that pushed me forward. And I think this is my way of paying it forward to my guys. And the age group, honestly, we already know that the older generation in the industry are exiting. The newer generation is where it's going to be. So if I have a hand in that up front, I'm already a winner in so many ways and I don't need any sort of award, you know, and I want to see them get this award next. So it's exciting. It's scary, but I think it's a fun ride along the way.
Yeah, every time somebody starts talking about average age in the industry, Christine, I always get a little bit like, because like I noticed the average.
Dude, age. I've been moving towards the needle all my life. Like I 21 years old, and the average age was 50 something when I was 21, and it's still 50 something at 50 something. And so, you know, now I'm just like, okay, I'm the average age. Yeah. I love defying things. So I hope I go beyond the average age, but it's getting lower. There's more millennials that are coming in. Kiran just said something so significant. We should all want to leave the mortgage industry in this time. I mean, what is history? What is evolution? What is humankind? We can go as deep on this philosophy as we want, but I mean, we're here for a finite number of years in time and history. How we leave our mark, how we push the needle forward in this industry and for women's causes. You know, we're not in a place today where women represent, you know, still equal numbers. And so I think we're all aware of that, and that's okay. It's okay with me that I'm here at this part of history. I feel really good about the direction we're going, and I feel really good about how it's going. And I think there's a ton of opportunity for women. And I think when women are right for the roles, they should be put in those roles. And what I'm doing, and people sometimes confuse this, you know, I'm not necessarily asking, you know, for equality. What I'm asking or doing is, you know, allow us to really sharpen our pencils and be the best choice. I want to help women be the best choice. And so if I can help them run their businesses profitably, you know, run them well, you know, to help them, you know, play this chess game at times that they are still playing out there in the world sometimes in the way that they speak or are heard, in fact, and it can be hard. Then I'm just going to be there to help, you know, answer that. But Kiran's got the right attitude because she's young and she's still looking to help the younger behind her. And if we can do this, if we can get the baton going where our generation that is exiting in the next 5 to 10 years, you know, gets your generation doing the same behind you, man, we're going to move the needle, you know?
You said a key word though, Christine, and that was equality.
Yeah.
And I'm always cognizant of that, right? Being a minority myself, right? And
sure.
Growing up in the industry for the past 28 years. And so with you two ladies, Corrina and Kiran, I mean, let's talk about equality for a second here, because I know, and Christine's included, I mean, all you guys have children, right? And so you're working, you know, slaving like everybody else, 12, 15, 18 hour days, you know, 7 days a week. But then you still got this home life waiting for you when you get home. Is that accurate? Like, I know myself, the one thing that I was always, I remember, like, this is a side tangent, but I remember my wife staying home with her, like, this is years ago, for like 3-4 days when the kids were like 7 and 9 or something. And I was like, man, I got to get back to the office. I needed out of there, right?
We feel the same way, by the way. Don't think we feel any different than you do. I'm kidding.
That's what I want to ask Corrina or Kiran, either one. I mean, when you guys leave, I mean, you guys are no longer women with vision. You're a mom that needs to do something. I mean, right? Or How do you guys make that change?
That hat never comes off. Our maternal hats are always on.
No, as a matter of fact, there's a couple more that come on because now I'm just not mom. I'm also daughter. So I'm taking care of my mom.
Great.
So now it's four generations deep for me. So I don't think it ever ends, Bobby.
I think one of the great things I want to say is this. I feel the conversation has been coming up with women with vision at our coaching firm. And that is that at least for two decades of my three decades that I was in business directly in the mortgage field, you know, I was trying to hide the femininity of my person. You know, I was trying to disguise myself. I wore, you know, black suits and the hair pulled back. And I was very cognizant not to sound like I was crabbing versus being constructive and just all these things that you know, you're trying to fit in at a table that might be predominantly male. And I don't know where I finally realized that we're going in the wrong direction with that. Like, we need to shine at what we have incredible strengths as maternal women, as beautiful women, as sexy women. I'm going to say that. I don't know if LinkedIn can handle that word, but I'm going to just put it out there. But as females, like, we have to shine at who we are and stop hiding and trying to be something we're not. I don't want to be a man. I want to show that as a woman, I can run a business as well as. So that's why I say I'm not chasing equality, because I don't think that solves the problem. Equal numbers isn't going to better companies. No. Not if you put women at tables they don't belong at and aren't ready to be at. Sure. You know, it's not about numbers. It's for me. It never has been. It's about the best person. I've denied women jobs that applied in the years that I was an executive. That we're not right, we're not ready. I've denied men, you know, for the same reason. Mm-hmm. And so I think the conversation for women with vision, and I have a lot of people that come up to me and say, oh, you're advocating for women now. And I'm a little bit knee-jerk defensive of that because I don't know that I'm advocating for anything. I am here to provide women a business tactical school the same way as the men to run their businesses to their greatest possible financial ability in the greatest possible way so that they are chosen as the best option for the job. And that is really as simply as I can say it.
So Kiran, yeah. I mean, back to you with the younger loan officers that I've seen in your group, you know what I mean? And the younger female loan officers, I mean, they come to you, they're obviously looking for advice. They're looking for role modelship, right? What advice would you give like a brand new female loan officer, you know what I mean, in 2021, right? Compared to what you may have received when you came into business.
I mean, first things first, that there's a very important characteristic that we as women have, no offense, Fabi, but we're multitaskers from like day one. I don't know how it happened, but we've been multitasking since we were born. So that has to, like, it's true, right?
Yes.
And that is what drives us into being able to do all sides of our lives the way we do it. You know, coming in brand new, you've got to create a balance and you've got to create that multitasking capacity at a higher end. And then you educate yourself, you build a strong network, you learn and you learn and you learn. And that's it. You're going to make mistakes. It is what it is. That's just part of the life. You know, you're going to make mistakes in any industry. It doesn't matter. But if you are okay with making mistakes and actually learn from it, you're going to be fine. And it doesn't matter what type of field you're in either, operations or in sales. You could go between the two and you're going to make mistakes and you just got to learn and keep pushing. You know, and you also have to have a goal in mind, right? So if you start off at some place, wherever it may be, you've got to see yourself somewhere else in 5 years. If you can't see yourself somewhere else in 5 years, then you need to rethink the whole thing anyways. And that's when you go and ask for help.
Or is it a different role in that same company, maybe? Or are you saying switching companies in 5 years? I mean,
it could be a variety of things, right? So if you're growing, you don't always want to end up. I don't think you should think about the company itself. You should really think about what your passion is going to lead you to. Right. Because the truth is, right now, if you're an asset to your company is going to do everything possible to keep you. Mm-hmm. They will create that position for you if that's what you want. Yeah. But you've got to show that you can do it, right? So, and then this is why Christine's program, like, I love 2020 Vision. I love the fact that you have so many resources that you can go there and you can say, okay, today I want to learn about marketing. Mm-hmm. Today I want to learn about growth. Like, the resources are out there. You just got to go find them or ask somebody and they'll lead you to it.
Yeah, absolutely. You know,
thank you, Kiran.
Oh, no. And I do mean it. She doesn't pay me to say that, by the way.
I mean, I heard recently they're just starting an elephant training session. So we're doing the elephant training sessions with
Chris. Yeah.
That's for super masters, though.
This is Fabi making a joke because we used an elephant in the room metaphor and it ended up backfiring on me anyways. But very, very funny inside joke.
Let me go on to Corrina.
The metaphor queen. They're going to kill me of doing that eventually. I promise you.
Corrina, I want to talk to you about mistakes and failings, because it was interesting when you and I were talking this morning, right? And you kind of like alluded to some things that you said, hey, maybe we should open this box up. And so I want to open that up because I think what Kiran just said about making mistakes and getting back up again is critical. Yeah. I think that's part of your story from what I picked up this morning. So
To piggyback on her is I'm thinking I have been that girl learning since 9 years old. You know, I've been a half elephant and a half whatever in the room and just really honestly been there, but like I fit in everywhere, but didn't fit in anywhere.
Yeah.
So I started at a young age setting goals and looking to see what my life would look like, nice. But I made a ton of mistakes along the way. But then I made a lot of good ones. Like we were talking, I moved out west. I moved both my kids out west. That was before cell phones, before pagers, before anything. Took two kids, picked up, went 3,500 miles away from every family member I had, lived 2 years there, and decided, hey, I'm out in Northwest. Everybody's opening in a business. Everything's going on. The .com was starting to happen. Whatever is going on here, I want to be part of. And I just came back to the East Coast and said, I've got to open a business. What is this going to look like? And I fell into mortgages. But I have been that girl learning ever since whatever. And you got to keep learning.
Yeah. When you fail, though, I mean, and either I think anyone can answer this question. When you guys fail, I mean, is there more pressure as a female professional in failing publicly, or is it equal? Because, I mean, look, I failed multiple times. I mean, you know, I can't tell, right? And at a certain point, you develop a tough skin, a callus almost to failing. Like, okay, if I failed, no big deal. At least I tried. You know what I mean? But you still don't want to fail in publicly in front of people, right? I mean, or Corrina, what do you think?
I think as a female, I covered mine up more for my family to be stronger. So meaning I don't feel like I let my family see how hard I struggled or how many times I did fail. You know, there's little tidbits that we talk about now because my son helps me run the operations with three different companies. And we talk about it. He said, and I remember, Mom, when you took a $2,000 loan out of my truck when he first started driving. And, you know, but there was only that one time. And I don't think I let them see enough of that. So I'm probably a failure at showing people I failed because I tried to always burden that on my shoulders no matter what and just get back up and whatever it was, just put the next plan in place and to set goals going forward and what that looked like. So I don't think they saw enough of that. So I wasn't really great at that.
So Kiran, let me ask you something. Is there more pressure to win the award again next year? I asked this to somebody else a few sessions ago. They had just won. I can't remember who it was, but somebody just won an award. I asked them, is there more pressure now to repeat yourself? Is there now pressure like, hey, I want to win again, or is one time enough?
No, so honestly, for me, I think winning again would be amazing. I mean, every award would be amazing, no doubt. But right now, what I've been doing is pushing my guys to move forward and making sure that they get nominated and they're the ones winning.
That's awesome.
Because at the end of the day, I know you can see the shelf behind me. There's one award, and that is for the Women with Vision Award. And most of my other awards are on my guys' shelves because every time they're the top producers and they're the ones up and above. I'm already winning, like I said. I don't have a problem with not having the actual plaque. But that does not mean, Christine, that I don't want another
one. I hear what you're saying, Kiran. I hear what you're saying. I mean, no, listen, you are a winner, first and foremost. Both of these women are. And I will tell you, exemplary of what it is Women with Vision stands for in every – you know, epitome of what they are. You know, both of these women lead other people, and yet they're incredible students. They show up themselves. They put their time in. They never skip required accountable self-development consulting. There's a lot they had to do to get where they are. And, you know, they've had to take curriculum and attend consulting and they just put the time in. And what I know about leading, and one of the great things about our organization, is that we give you a platform to be a leader here, to hone those leadership skills, whether you're writing in our magazines or you're hosting classes as a master student or a coach. And it's so important, because if you want to be a great student of life or your business, be a teacher. You know, if you want to be the best at something, when I was going to college, I got my AFA certification and in fitness and my CNA in nutrition. And I knew I was becoming an originator, but I, on the peripheral of being an originator for 12 years, I was a physical trainer. And I had always aspired to be one of those women that had like the physical trainer body. And I knew that the only way I would ever reach that level would be to be the teacher. And so I did that and I got certified. And I have to tell you, I was in incredible shape in my 20s. That has re-gifted me all of my life, a centering of health and wellness that I take with me, that I still teach, that I practice. And so it's been the gift that keeps on giving. These two set that example. And so I think, you know, winning is about, you know, these guys stepping up and setting the example and being great students themselves.
Yeah, it's interesting, because that was a question I was going to ask you, Christine, is the qualities you look for when you're screening the winners, right? I mean, obviously, we have two great examples here.
Yeah.
I think you just went through a pretty good list, kind of like preempting that question, not without even realizing it was here. But, I mean, what are some of the qualities besides, I mean, look, you're talking about leadership, you're talking about giving away, studying. I mean, there's a lot of, more than just numbers is what I'm hearing, right? It's not about the actual production. There's something beyond that.
It is about production in part, because we want, one of the things that you have to be to become a master student or to become a woman with vision is you have to have ascending business results. So we collect financial forecasting here, or we have some semblance of these guys' numbers through our accounting financial forensics department. And, you know, that gives us a picture as to whether they're growing or maintaining their businesses in a healthy manner. And that is a factor. The question more becomes, are they declining, or are there negative aspects to this person? Are they not in a position to receive what you would consider to be an ascending award? Growth, self-development, self-investment, you know, living the example to other people. And I would tell you, I sat in the audience of, you know, last year's winners, and every single one of them was the epitome. This industry is really, really on the right track, because they're turning out incredible leaders in this area. So really proud to have this.
Is this award only for people in the mortgage industry?
So it's in the finance space, which spans the spectrum of banking, brokering, lending, and banking finance. So we had a few outliers to the mortgage industry that were in business, banking, finance. And we just felt compelled to make that umbrella that wide and broad, because this is about all women that are contributing to the American finance. And so we had some women executives that are out there doing servicing executive work, and, you know, are out there in the banks, in secondary markets and compliance, and the outliers to ops and production, but they're just as importantly moving the needle for all of us. We actually had one winner from India, who runs the Women with Vision division of India. And her and I met on Facebook, and she has a logo, Women with Vision. Her logo is purple with the words Women with Vision. When she saw my Women with Vision, we actually met kind of under a little bit of adversity, because she wanted to kick me out of Facebook because I was using the same name. And we began a conversation, and that conversation led to a real understanding about us being in different parts of the world with the same thing, except for their Women with Vision. You know, she admitted that, you know, the women don't have the same luxuries as we have here. It's a little scarier to stand on platforms there and be able to self-advocate. It's actually kind of scary for them to even nominate themselves or get nominated for the award, mm-hmm. that they have to keep their winnings like private and community. She is brave amongst her peers there. And when the award came, she went for it. And so we celebrated privately. She won this award. She couldn't come to America to accept the award, but they had a whole celebration in their Women with Vision in India that she won this American award. And it was like, and I promise you, I get chills saying it right now, and it's emotional for me. I know for this woman, it was like the day of her life to receive this award. Like it was that thing. And what I love about having her be one of our winners is that I know that far off in that space, way over there, I made a difference here, you know, in that world over there. And that's what it's all about. That's what it's all about.
That's, yeah. So, Corrina, I want to come back to you. I know you have yourself muted, so unmute yourself for a second here. Hang tight with us. Come on, Corrina. big vision eyeglasses. Being a second year winner, right? I mean, because now you.
First year winner. Second year vision, but first year winner.
First year winner, second year with vision. Got it. So now I got to rephrase my question for you. No big deal.
Okay.
I'm a professional. I can do this.
I don't want to mislead anybody.
No, actually, I was going to talk to you about your branding because I've always seen this thing with you. You kind of like highlight your hair orange. You got this orange cushion behind you, you got orange pictures. You got this bottle of wine. It's not orange. So I'm like, why is that bottle of wine there? But so you really, and then you're.
It's logo, got my initials on it.
And then you got your CMS logo in orange, I think, if I'm not mistaken, right? So, I mean, as a woman with vision, I mean, you actually saw this color connection everywhere in your life. Is that accurate?
Yeah. And it's like a mood color. You know, I feel like it changes the mood. And orange is a mood color. Mm-hmm. So it really changes, like when you, if you get up and you're in a blue room, no offense, you got blue behind you, but if you get up and you're in a blue bathroom, you wake up and you're a little blue. If you get up and you're in an orange, my bathroom's not orange, but if you get up and you're in an orange bathroom, but my ceiling is orange when we walk in the room, you know, and it's like, you know, it just like, okay, I have to look at it. I have to brighten my eyes. I have to see what's coming, you know? And I think for me, it's just really, it is a little bit part of my branding. So my glasses now have become part of my branding. I don't know why, but everybody's like, where's your glasses? So everywhere I go, I have to have them, but just because I have to see. But but the color is more or less the actual, I think it's the mood. I think it makes me feel good. We have a lot of wall art too. So words as far as different phrases in each room in our office.
Yeah.
And I think it's just inspiring and it gives people a little bit of, I guess I feel a little bit more grateful walking in the door than just walking into an office that just has four walls and not a lot of color.
Yeah.
So can I say something real quick? So one time when I was thinking about changing, like, you know, when the market crashed and a company came down and visited me, they hated my orange.
Really? Literally.
And he was like, well, if you decide to sell CMS or you want to come on board, the first thing you're going to go is green and something else. I can't remember what color it was, green and yellow. It wasn't green and blue. It was just green. It was like grass green. And I was like, that is so ugly. And it's not me. Like I have green in my office, as you can see, and I'm wearing green, but I was just, it was a deal breaker.
Wow. So it was a deal breaker.
The color was a deal breaker, but glad I didn't do it, you know, 8 years ago. So here I am. But yes, it was a deal breaker.
I think Corrina does an amazing job with her brand and she's put a lot of time into her brand too. She's done videography. You know, it is color coordinated, but you recognize it. I recognize CMS logoing everywhere. And so, you know, I know First Option, you know, works at it as well. And you guys have taken leaps and bounds ahead in the last year with branding and whatnot. So it's so important, right?
I actually want to ask Kiran because her office is kind of Suwanee, Georgia. I've never been visiting. I promise I will be there. Anybody listening, I'm on the record. I'm going to be there this time. And we're going to go to Tupelo Honey's. You guys also have big wordings everywhere in the office. And you have like these catchphrases. I mean, is that something that you wanted also? Like Corrina was saying, it kind of like motivates you, pumps you up. I mean, what was that about?
Yeah, so I didn't completely agree with our green color when it first came about. And it was just like, you know, it has to grow on you. So it's grown on us. But we wanted a space where when people came in, they would be happy. They'd be motivated. It was a fun place. It was their safe space. Mm. It was a place where they were going to be able to achieve everything and anything they wanted. So the words went on the wall. We painted stuff green. We put the logo up. And then we let the staff do whatever they want. Anybody that comes in, they can assign or write on our boards, whatever they want to do. It's gotta be someplace where you have fun. It's a little bit of you everywhere you go, right? So mm-hmm. if it's the color or if it's the phrase, it doesn't matter. It's just gotta be you.
Yeah, no, I see this more and more now, Christine, where women in leadership roles are bringing their creativity, their sensitivity into the workspace.
Mm-hmm.
And it allows for more, I think Kiran just said, feel good when you walk into space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I can work here. Like, this is comfortable. This is where my creativity, my energy will flow now.
I think there's one universal thing that we've not given, you know, complete consideration till recent years to, and that is the maternal effects women can create in working environments that can make environments very, very, feel very safe, feel very loving. And I think that that's a power we've been stuffing once again, because we've been, you know, made to believe from decades past that we should be ashamed of it. We're not anymore. I mean, we're out of the box completely. We can't be put back in, let's just say it. My office looks like something like a Tiffany store. I got the teal Tiffany and silver thing going on. What's that?
Lighting like barn.
Yeah, we got barn doors and it's got splashes of white. But, you know, men come and do workshops in my corporate office. And they always say, man, I feel so at ease here. I feel so comfortable here. I feel, you know, just it's such a warm environment. And I think we need warmth. Who doesn't, what human on earth doesn't want warmth in the workplace, doesn't want to feel like the place we sit for 8 or 10 hours a day and beyond. And believe me, that's like the part-timers I feel, but I don't want to promote long hours because that's not cool either. But you know what I'm saying? It's, I think it's a good thing. Men have mothers, sisters, and daughters. And I'm pretty sure they love those three women, and they have wives and girlfriends and spouses, and they have workers and coworkers and subordinates that they admire. And I'm sure a lot of them really appreciate the effects that women, when they're in their real zone, being them real selves, bring to the table, you know, and anyone that says that that's not true, I would argue is a person that's not in touch with themselves. And has issues themselves if they can't relate to that, you know.
Well, look, guys, we are up at that 30-minute time frame that I promised everybody we'd keep the show at this time.
Awesome.
I couldn't have dreamt a better panel. I'm not joking with you guys when I say this. I want to thank you all for being part of the Laugh, Lend, Eat first ever live show on LinkedIn. This was a great panel. This was a great discussion. We're going to see how many times we actually do this, you know what I mean? So we're all going to have a discussion. I want to thank John Perry, who came out and produced this show for us, because if it was me, you guys would be recording the Zoom call with me again. So I was going to go if that was that. And so once again, thank you so much for being out here with us. Hope you guys have a great day. John, take us out of here.
We hope you enjoyed this edition of Laugh, Lend, and Eat, the podcast. You can now enjoy Fabi's article, Laugh, Lend, and Eat, featured in the Vision magazine. Please be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel, where each month, we are giving away some swag for our lucky listener to show off. Thank you to our sponsors for their continued support, First Option Mortgage and One Good One Recruiting. And remember, you have to be something, so be kind.